the VOC Podcast Network. The era of the drunk cast has arrived. Strap in. The ghost in J1 will now infiltrate your minds and split your wings. Drunk Funk Productions, bitch.
And welcome back to Drunk Cast. This is your host, J1, with my co-host here, Ghost. We got JP the Hustler on the line from Grim Reality Entertainment. How you doing today, brother?
Good, man. Good. How y'all doing?
Oh, great, man. Great.
Wonderful.
Enjoying the nice cool weather up here.
Is it nice over there? It's not nice where I'm at. I'm in Dallas, and it's fucking raining cats and dogs right now, so I miss the Cali weather right now.
Yeah, it's been kind of chilly out the last few days, but kind of enjoying it from the summer weather. So.
Right.
What put you out in Texas? You were normally based out of SoCal before, correct?
Yeah, no, in Southern California all my life until a year ago, and pretty much because I had the opportunity to buy a house out here, and so I took that opportunity, and here I am in Texas. So I've been getting all the jokes about the cowboy hats and spurs and all that shit, but I'm back in Cali all the time because still the whole label's out there, and like most of the shows that I throw are in California, whether it be Southern California or in Sacramento. So I'm back in California at least 4, 5, 6 times a year. So that's still where my heart is. I'll always be California.
Hell yeah.
Can we be looking forward to seeing any GRE cowboy hats anytime soon?
Yeah, that's not going to happen. So
how are you liking it out there, like, compared to California? Is there much of a big, like, scene change to the music and all that?
The scene is quite a bit different out here. I remember I was doing shows out here back around 2010. That was when I was with Insane Poetry. And we were doing shows in Austin. We did a few in Dallas. And there was a pretty decent underground scene in Dallas at the time. It's not so much that way anymore. Austin's still pretty decent, but as far as Dallas itself, really not much going on out here. The closest city that I know has any kind of scene is Fort Worth, which is about an hour away from where I'm at. But still, it's not. The scene's a little bit different than it is in California. It's not as organized. I mean, I've had a lot of people who I've met at shows out here, like when I just did the Austin show a couple weeks ago. You know, like, oh, are you throwing shows? Or are you doing any shows out here in Texas? And it's really hard to kind of figure out the scene, because I know a couple promoters who've done some shows in this area and they haven't gone well. So I'm still trying to figure out what the scene is, and really mainly it's I'm trying to figure out the underground artists that are out here, like you know, classes from out here. You know, he signed to LSP now, he's doing his thing, but I'm not even sure how many shows he actually is doing out in Dallas and Fort Worth area himself. I know he pops up on different shows here and there, but it just doesn't seem like the underground scene out here is what it was, say, 5 years ago. So the California scene is really popping. I mean, you know, we have almost too many artists and shows going on. You know what I mean? There's always something going on, which I love. There's so much opportunity for artists in California. I just haven't found the right, the right niche out here yet. You know, I've still been kind of hunting to see what artists are serious about their craft out here and kind of who the artists are. So I haven't quite placed my finger on that yet. So for
there
right
might be
now,
some
I'm
untapped
still
talent out there. That's what would be nice about that.
Say that one more
there
time.
There might be some nice untapped talent out there you can find. That would be nice.
Yeah, no, definitely. I mean, that's something that I thought about absolutely. And, you know, there is a scene in Houston and, you know, around Spring, Texas, like Tommy Necro and, you know, a bunch of cats out that way, White Noise, and some cats I've met from shows doing in Houston and Austin. There's definitely a scene in Houston and Austin, and I'm sure there's a scene in Dallas. I just haven't found it yet, you know, and like you said, yeah, if I come across some talent out here or some right situations, I'd definitely be down to do some stuff out here, because that's really part of what I like to do is invest in different situations, you know, partner up with other promoters or other situations to, you know, mutually benefit everyone involved. So I'm always open for, you know, opportunities that can work. So I have some potential ones in Austin and in Houston. I just really haven't made anything happen in Dallas yet. So hopefully that'll happen soon.
Yeah, that'll be sweet. Speaking of different opportunities you go at, there's actually some drama on Facebook recently on this. MC Val, very, very interesting, talented artist from what I've been checking out on her. Does she actually speak any English or is she full-blown Russian?
She's from Ukraine. She speaks Russian. She knows very, like less than 1% of English. She doesn't speak English. She can read some English, and she can write a little bit in English, but she pretty much, Russian is her language.
Okay, yeah, I wanted to get her on the show, but that's something, like, it might be a little rough.
So. Yeah, it would be tough if she didn't have an interpreter to kind of make that happen, so,
yeah. What made you guys sign her? Like, that's kind of a interesting angle you went out there for a Russian horrorcore rapper that, she's doing really good for herself, too. Like, I was checking out some of her videos, her In My City videos, 260-plus thousand views. Euro Maiden, 154-plus thousand views. Like, really making a name for herself. I don't know what the hell she's saying, but by watching her real graphic, in-depth videos, you get a very fine point of what she's trying to talk about or rap about.
Yeah, I can break it down for you. As far as how she came to GRE, she actually approached me about coming on the GRE about 2 years ago. And the reason she was interested with GRE is because, you know, the original founding artist of GRE is myself and Insane Poetry, you know, and it was originally mainly a horrorcore label that we also did West Coast hip hop and other stuff. But, I guess she saw the activity and, you know, what we were doing, and we were really active with, you know, pushing a lot of projects and promoting, and kind of, you know, we have a nice big team, and, you know, we all kind of push and promote each other. And, I guess that mixed with, you know, the legacy, like I said, with the Insane Poetry thing, you know, she, wanted to come on board. And so, you know, at first I thought the same thing, like, how would she fit in, because she doesn't speak any English. But when I started listening to the music, and she actually broke down for me what her music is about and what she's about, I was really interested. And so it kind of went from there, and we went really slow at first. We did some collab songs, and, you know, she already had a project pretty much done she had been working on. She just needed a push with, you know, getting it put out and some promotion and stuff like that. And so, you know, we took a chance and went for it. And since then, it's kind of really blossomed. Now, the reason why she has a lot of popularity right now, or a lot of buzz about her, is because she's very politically active. You know, she does horrorcore, but the other side of what she does is political hip-hop. And she's in Ukraine, and I don't know if you know about what's going on right now, but there's a civil war in Ukraine.
Yeah,
and basically
part of it.
What it is that you have... because, you know, Ukraine used to be part of Russia at one point. And so you have people in Ukraine who have a loyalty to Russia. And then you have people in Ukraine who want to be completely separate, not tied to the Russian economy or anything. So they're revolting against anything having to do with Russia. But the way they're going about it is in a very militant and violent way. Now, MC Val, she is opposed to that. She's not opposed to Ukraine being separate, but she's opposed to kind of the violent upheaval of the rebels. And she does have allegiance to Russia, because she does look at that as the mother country. But she's Ukrainian, so she's kind of caught in the middle. Now, what her music really is about, like Euro Maiden and all that stuff that you see, it's talking about basically the corruption of the government and kind of the influences of a lot of the Western countries, and kind of, you know, it's kind of a chess match and a pissing contest. Yeah. And so what you have stuck in the middle is you have Ukrainian citizens who are dying. you know, every day it's almost like a genocide over there, what's happening. So it's a real civil war. It's something she's really passionate about, something she could probably tell you way better than me.
Oh, yeah.
But this is what I understand from what, you know, she's explained to me and what a good chunk of her music is about. So really half of her music is like horrorcore and the other half is political. And so it's really the political side that's really gotten her a big buzz. And you saw, I mean, she has videos that have 200,000, 300,000, 400,000, 500,000 views on them. And it's all her political stuff.
So, yeah, and they're intense videos, too. Like, wow.
Yeah, no, she's very intense. She's very intense. And I think part of that is, you know, her horrorcore influences. You know, she really is into that crazy shit. So when she does the political stuff, she has no problem showing you, you know, look, this is the real death and the destruction and all this that goes on with war. She has no problem showing that. So
I like that, though, because, like, it really gets her point across. Because, like, you know, not speaking Russian or being able to understand her lyrics directly, just sitting there watching and listening, like, just it gives the very exact point of what's going on, like the atrocities that are happening out there.
And I think that's what good music is. I mean, you know, you don't necessarily have to understand, you know, every word to understand the story. It's just like, you know, this may be weird for me to say, but like opera, you know, people who listen to opera in Italian, you know what I mean? You may not understand the words, but you understand the feeling that's being conveyed. You know, and if it's good music and the person who's, you know, the artist behind it is very passionate about what they do, you can feel and understand what they're trying to get across.
Oh, most definitely. Like, that's what, after I watched a couple of her videos, that's kind of how I felt with her music. I was like, all right, like, I get the point here. You know, it's not annoying to listen to. It's actually very intriguing music. Like, my neighbors came in, I was listening to it the other day, and they were like, what the fuck are you listening to, dude? I'm like, oh, yeah.
Yeah, we made a joke. Like, I made a joke with her when she first came on. We first started listening to music. It was kind of a running little joke, but it always sounded like, you know, she's fucking possessed. She's so fucking, you know, violent, and it's like she's fucking possessed. We always joke about, like, if you listen to MC Val, she'll fucking possess you, and you'll be stigmata and shit. Like, it's just, she sounds crazy on the mic, and I love it. I mean, that's the draw of why a lot of people like her. You know, even if you don't understand what she's saying, it's just the intensity, and a lot of people don't know she's a chick. They think she's like a young guy. You know,
yeah, I saw some comments on YouTube about that. They're like, this is a chick or a dude?
Right, because she's so intense, and you're not used to, you know, a lot of girls rapping that way. Like, the only one I know in the underground that I could compare to who's like that is, like, Smalls One from LSP. I have a lot of respect for Smalls One. I actually did a track with her and MC Val on it, and so I, you know, Smalls One is another chick that I really have respect for, who's really intense, and I mean, she can hang with the guys. And I, you know, I like female MCs who are like that, who are like, you know, I'm going to prove what I can do on record or on stage. I'm not going to rely on, you know, fucking taking, you know, half-nude photos online and get you to follow me because I look good. You know, it's like, hey, I'm going to fucking dress like a guy and fucking, I'm going to, you know, spill my guts on record and have you respect me as an MC. I mean, I respect girls who are like that.
Right. That track you were just talking about, is that coming up off your Mad Scientist album?
The one with Smalls One and Val?
Yeah.
That was actually on my prior record, Disinfected, but then we did a remix to it. That's a digital single right now, and it's going to, we're dropping a GRE comp beginning of next year called Remixes, and it's going to be remixes of a bunch of different tracks that we've done. Either it's going to include some, you know, additional artists on it, or, you know, the beats are completely redone or whatever. But yeah, that nice. Song has been out. It's called Wolf and Sheep, and it's on my Disinfected album, and then there's also a remix that's a single that, you know, is everywhere, iTunes and all that stuff.
Will you be producing that album yourself also?
Which album? The remixes?
Yeah.
Yes, it's going to be pretty much, yeah, it's pretty much all me producing that, right. that record. In fact, I pretty much produce, I would say, 80% of everything that comes out on GRE. We have a couple other producers that do stuff, like Cali G has his own producer, Master Green, who does pretty much 90% of his production on his album, and I'll help out with a track here or there. He has some other people that help out. And then Val, she also has her own producer as well. So 90% of what she does, she has her own production team that does what she does. Pretty much every other project on GRE is mostly my production. So, okay.
Yeah, I did a little research into you. You got a bunch of stuff. What, 25 plus albums you've produced, 5 released, 40 to 50 contributed to.
Yeah, I've been busy, yeah, especially since, I would say since about 2011, I've really kicked it into another gear, been really busy. I mean, I think since 2013, we've dropped 8 to 10 albums every year.
Well, 2011 is when you took full control of GRE, correct?
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct.
Because you were, you guys went into business, what, 2001 with Psycho of Insane Poetry?
Exactly. 2001, we founded the label, and then in the end of 2010, he moved to Denver and became part of LSP.
There you go. But did it put a lot more on your plate as far as taking full ownership of the record label, considering you're producing and also being an artist at the same time?
You know what? That's something that I always wanted. I had another independent label prior to GRE, starting back when I was like 18, and I got my feet wet at that point, already working with other artists and doing that kind of thing, you know, although it was a failure, and that was mainly because, you know, I was young and inexperienced, and then throughout the course of the next, you know, 10, 15 years, gaining experience working with different people, and, you know, I have to absolutely give it up to Psycho of Insane Poetry, because I learned a lot about the artist end because of him. I always had a knack at business and organization. That's always been my thing. The development of myself as an artist and as a producer, absolutely, you know, I definitely give him props on that, because, you know, he was always real with me with a lot of stuff, and I'll definitely say that I grew as an artist and a producer working with him from 2001 through 2010. When I took over GRE in 2011, you know, it was really something I was ready for, because we really didn't have a lot of artists on the label up to that point. We had phases where we would have a few different artists, but they would come and go. And so we never really had a steady team of artists on the label. And so I was really excited to have the opportunity to, you know, really have a real foundation of a label and get a core group of artists and kind of move. And so GRE really has been that since 2011. We've had a few artists that have come and gone, but for the most part, we've had, you know, a good core, and we probably maintained at least 5 artists on the label at all time. Right now we're at 9. So, and we've held steady at about 9-10 for the last year or two.
Yeah, you guys got a killer lineup, man. A killer lineup.
Oh, thanks, man. I mean, go ahead.
I was saying, not a problem, man. Like, do I love a bunch of your lineup? Like, Edrum cracks me up when I see him live. Like, he, on stage, right. What a guy.
Yeah, no, he's definitely, you know, our comic of the group. He's someone who, you know, does love to have a good time and keeps it light. I mean, his first album was called, you know, Who They Come to Party With, and that's really...
Love that album.
You know, his attitude is, you know, if you come to the show, who'd you come to party with? You know, Ed is that guy you want to party with and be around. And, I mean, on stage, he's got some really, really great show songs, you know, songs that just make you feel good, want you to get into it. You like it's a party. I mean, that's what Eddie's good at. And, yeah, I mean, Edrum, actually, it's funny because Ed Rum came on the label through another artist who used to be on the label, who's no longer on, and Ed ended up staying on the label, and, you know, he's flourished, and it's been, you know, a really good thing for him, and of course for GRE to have him aboard. So, and the diversity on the label is the other thing that, you know, I'm really proud about, because we have so many different kinds of artists on the label, you know, and Eddie just, you know, the two artists you talked about, I mean, from Ed Rum to MC Val, I don't think you can get more opposite than that.
Right.
You know what I mean? And we have, you know, everything in the middle, you know, and everyone kind of has their own thing. And the other thing I like is the label's mainly consisted of vets. You know, these are veterans. A lot of these people, before they came aboard GRE, they were already doing their own thing. They either were on other labels before, they had their own small labels. They got their experience. You know what I mean? They paid their dues, they did their thing. And so, you know, one of the main things that I'm able to provide a lot of artists is, like I said, that structure and the organization, and also, you know, financial backing to help, you know, do things. So, I mean, not everyone is in the position where they need that. You know, there's some artists that are very self-sufficient, that they have their, you know, their plan, their mindset, they have financial resources themselves and all that, and they do their thing, but not everyone, you know, was in that boat. Some people just want to be an artist. They're like, hey, this is my craft. I just want to focus on, you know, writing and making the best music I can or whatever, and they don't always want to have to deal with all the other stuff. You know what I mean? And that's where I can come in and kind of help guide them. And the other thing is I try to be 50-50 partners with everyone on the label. You know, and there's always opportunities for every... What was that?
I said, that's good.
Yeah, no. I try to work it so that everything is a 50-50 partnership. It's 50-50 in, 50-50 out. So everyone has the opportunity to, well, obviously, you know, everyone wants to try to make money, you know, but in the early stages, you know, the money is not there. So it's all about, you know, building opportunities, you know, and just being able to have your hands in a lot of stuff. I would like, well, one of the things that I always try to instill in any artist I ever work with is you have to look at yourself as a business entity. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Ed Rum, he's a business entity. Cali G, he's a business entity. Everything you do in your music career affects the way your branding is. So you want to make sure that all the decisions you make and everything you do musically is going to affect your brand in a positive way. Because once you start looking at yourself as a business entity and a brand, it's going to change the way you go about things. You know what I mean? A lot of people are, you know, some artists, I'm sure you've seen it in the industry, you know, they're really wishy-washy, you know, they hustle hard for a few minutes and then they kind of fall back and disappear for a long time.
Oh, yeah.
Sometimes they may maybe not make the smartest decisions with certain things. Maybe they get really emotional about things, whatever it may be. And, you know, they don't realize that everything that you do when you're an artist, especially you're on Facebook and social media now, like, everyone is judging you. Your potential fans are looking at all this stuff that you post up on Facebook and the stuff that you do at shows and all that, and they're making a decision whether they want to buy into your brand or not, you know? And the biggest mistake I see is a lot of people, you know, they don't even realize the fans they lose before they even have them because they're not acting in their own best interest to boost their own brand. You know what I mean? So that's one of those things that I try to really, you know, instill, because I was told that a long time ago, and so I just passed the knowledge. I mean, nothing I say is original. You know, everything's already been done and said before, but I try to gather all this knowledge I get from, you know, different people, different experiences, different things, and just pass it along, you know? And I think that's, as a good label owner, a good manager, anyone who's in a position where you're, you know, helping to guide other people, you know, that's your role, you know?
Yeah, earlier you mentioned you took over for GRE. Who was the main owner before you?
It was me and Psycho 50-50. So we were 50-50 owners of GRE. I just took over the other 50%. Yeah.
Damn computers.
No worries. I was just saying I've been there where you gotta, you know, drive to the city you're performing, go straight to the venue, get out, and you're in the club and your mind's spinning, you don't even know what's going on. So
right.
I try to do that as little as possible. So like we have we're doing Reno next weekend.
Yes, sir.
For Mystic's birthday bash, and of course you guys are rocking with us too. And we got actually Sacramento acts, Reno acts, and SoCal acts other than GRE that are going up there to perform. So it's actually a really, really good show. And we also have Matt Choppa from Boise who's coming to do the show as well. So it's actually going to be a really, really cool show. We got acts from all over. So, and it's Shannon's last show. So I really want to go out with a bang for her and make sure she has a great birthday bash and a great show, but
I'm sure she,
you know,
will.
I'm flying out there. I'm gonna get there at like noon so I can get to my hotel room, you know, chill out, have a drink or two, maybe kick it with some drunk funks, maybe some GRE people for a few hours before we gotta hit the venue. You know, that's what I'm trying to do.
You know, we're coming out the day before, so we just booked a hotel rooms out for the whole weekend. We're like, screw it, man.
Right.
Nice.
A little easier, you know, get out of town for the weekend too. Sacramento gets a little old after a while.
That's good. I haven't been to Reno. I haven't been to Reno in 4 years. That was the last show, or the last time I was in Reno was for a show as well. I did at Ruben's Cantina when Dan Hubbard was throwing shows there. I don't know if he still does it, but he was doing like those Thursday night shows or whatever. And so
I think we did one of those actually. We had Slow Mo was on one of those
shows.
Really? Yeah. Don't remember which one.
So yeah, I mean, this was like a long time ago. This must have been 4 years ago. But that was my first time ever in Reno, and it was cool. I liked it. I mean, Reno's a cool little spot. So I was definitely looking forward to, you know, getting back out to Reno and perform again for sure.
Yeah, and Shannon's a fun person to perform with and do shows with. Like, she gets pretty wild out there.
Right.
Like that last show we did with
her. I haven't
Reno.
Actually.
You haven't done a show with her
was
yet?
Pretty crazy.
Oh, yeah, dude. Like,
no, actually, we haven't.
The last show we did with her in Reno, we had somebody. Somebody actually rode a bike into the side of this venue and actually ran a person over and on a bicycle out of nowhere. Shannon grabbed him and threw him over a table and shit. It was great.
Wow.
Yeah, crazy shit.
I know, she don't take no shit.
No, she don't.
She was pissed. She had a big-ass tire mark on the side of her leg where he ran into her, and then, like, she picked him up, must have chucked him, like, 6 feet, dude. It was great.
Wow.
Yeah, wild things happen up there. Especially when you're leaving the show at like 2:30 in the morning, wasted, trying to find food. You can actually walk up and get like Alberto's and shit at like 4 in the morning there. It's kind of sweet.
That's dope.
You do that around here, people think you're trying to rob them.
Right?
Yeah, that's not good. No, I remember when we did those, what was it, River's Edge? Was that the venue?
Yeah.
Yeah, when we did those River's Edge shows. And I like the venue's cool, but like, the surrounding area, I mean, you got like hookers and crackheads riding around on bicycles. I've never seen that before. Right. So that was pretty interesting.
Were you on the show where we all got locked in the building at one time? There was like a shooting going on down the street and they forced all of us inside and locked the place down?
Oh. I was not at that show.
Oh, that one was great. Yeah, they were like throwing guns out in the middle of the street, like driving right past there on West Capitol. Cops came running up to like, everybody get the fuck inside.
What venue was that?
Yeah, that was the River's Edge.
Oh, shit.
Yeah.
Is that when no one does shows at River's Edge anymore?
No, I think everybody's got tired of doing them there, honestly.
No, I know. Well, I mean, River's Edge is cool, but, I mean, yeah, it's a good spot for a really small show. I'm really glad that we've moved over to the Blue Lamp. I really like that venue.
Our Blue Lamp, sweet.
It's a good-sized venue, good-sized stage. The sound is good. Like, yeah, I really like that venue. I mean, that's part of the reason why we had to move the show to January, because I really didn't want to have to go in any other venue but Blue Lamp. I wanted a Saturday, and we couldn't get a Saturday in the month that I wanted. So you know, I was like, fuck it, push it back, because I'm not, I don't want, I mean, I don't think shows that are not on Fridays or Saturday nights are generally successful. I mean, it can be, but, you know, why put the odds against you? You know what I mean? A Thursday, a Sunday show, whatever. It's just tough to get people to really come out. They got work the next day, you know. I mean, you can have a good show, but I just prefer to do Friday, Saturday shows if I can. You know, that way no one has to worry about work the next day. Everyone's in the mood to party. It's the weekend. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So that's why I really wanted to hold out for that Sacramento show, for the Cali Connected show up there. I wanted to make sure we got a Saturday, and I wanted to do it at the Blue Lamp. So I was fine waiting a little bit of time because, you know, like you said, everyone's sick of River's Edge, and I didn't want to do a venue like that. There's nothing wrong with River's Edge because we did many shows there.
Oh, yeah.
But Blue Lamp is a little bit of a step up.
Oh, yeah, especially, like, the sound's way better there. Freaking, you don't have the crackhead whores walking down the street.
Right.
Yeah, like I said, the fucking bicycle whores. That was really interesting.
Yeah, be out in the fucking parking lot burning. Here come the bicycle people. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, for real. For real.
Hey, could I hit that? My dog, you got a sore on your lip. Sorry.
You got some shit on your lip.
So, you got your Mad Scientist album dropping in, shit, what is that, tomorrow? Or no, that
no,
was a...
it actually dropped.
Sorry,
I
wrote that down wrong. I'm sorry.
You probably wrote it down when we were originally supposed to have it,
yeah,
2 weeks ago or whatever.
Exactly.
But, yeah, no, it dropped 2 weeks ago. It's my fifth studio album. In my own humble opinion, I feel like it's my best record to date. Everyone should feel like that about their new project coming out, but I really do feel like it's my best project in that the consistency from the first song to the last song, it's really cohesive. It kind of has a theme running throughout or a similar vibe running throughout. I really took the record back to that 90s boom bap, you know, hip hop kind of feel. You know, most of my music, if you've heard my records or even the production I do for a lot of other people, I have big influence of like that boom bap hip hop, but I definitely have that West Coast influence, especially that 90s, you know, influence. And so you know, for this record I really wanted to or I just was really inspired by more of that classic 90s like East Coast boom bap hip hop music, and you know, just put kind of my own little, you know, tinge on it. And I'm really happy with the product that came out. I think lyrically it's definitely some of my best work. I really don't have a lot of collabs on it outside of GRE. I have, you know, my GRE people on it. I have a couple others. I have this group out of Spain called Chronica Lyrica that's on a song. They're fucking phenomenal. And I actually found out about them because of MC Val. She did a collab with them. They did kind of a political type of track together. And I heard them. I was like, man, I love these guys. Who are they? And so she put me up on them. And they're really into that retro hip-hop sound. So I was like, man, this is a perfect fit. So I got them on it. I think that's... Oh, and Matt Choppa's on the record. And I think that's it outside of GRE. I think the rest of the people on this is GRE collabs. So I really kept it kind of in the family for the record.
Are you going to have hard copies of it up in Reno?
Absolutely.
All right, cool.
Absolutely, I will.
Definitely want to get my hands on that. I don't like digitally downloading stuff these days. Like, it's kind of, it's cool, but I like having the original artwork and everything that comes along with it, you know?
Right.
No, absolutely. And there's, you know, there's still a lot of people who are like that. I mean, you know, even though the trend is, you know, the majority of people do download music or they stream the music now, but there are still, you know, diehard fans that still want to have that hard copy, you know, with the liner notes, with the artwork and all that, you know. So, I mean, they're the ones who are really keeping, you know, even CD sales still going because, you know, a lot of people are like, oh, fuck CDs, I'll just release stuff, you know, digitally. And I tell them, hey, you still should press some CDs because there's going to be people out there who really want to have it on CD. Plus, you can't fucking sign a digital copy. You know, there's still people who want you to autograph you know, they're physical. It's like you can't autograph a digital copy. So I always think it's smart for artists to at least press, you know, even just a short amount, a small amount of hard copies just for those fans who want to have those hard copies.
Hey, autographs are fun, too. I remember the Black Sheep show that we did. That was my first time I got asked for an autograph, like, ever, and I didn't even know what the fuck to do at first. I was like, how do I do
I've
this?
I've been there. I still am like that. You know, when I'll tell you the first time I ever got asked for an autograph was in Denver. I was there for one of Scum shows. I was either the Gore Fest or one of the other shows, maybe Underground Unbound, one of the ones that he had back in like 2006, 2007. I remember, you know, that was the first time that I got hit up for an autograph, and I looked behind me. I was like, who, me? Like, who are you talking to? You know what I mean? It's still a trip when people are like that and want to get an autograph because, you know, I don't feel myself on the level of, you know, when you see quote-unquote stars who are, you know, on that level where people will want their autographs or whatever. So I'm still, like, crazy humbled whenever anyone, you know, wants me to sign a CD or a T-shirt or whatever. I mean, it's the coolest thing, but it's very humbling.
Yeah, it's just tricky because every time you're doing your signature, normally it's on, like, business-level stuff. And then, like, now you're just doing your signature for somebody to keep. Like, they're appreciative of it. You're like, okay, normally you're just jotting it down. You're like, all right, yeah, get it over with.
Right. Yeah, no, I feel you. It's always like, what do I write? If I write this to this guy, am I going to sound gay if I'm like, you know, hey, Mike, lots of love. Oh, no, I don't mean that. You know, yeah.
Yeah, next thing you got like five lines of Sharpie on your album. Here you go,
with
dog.
A bunch of fucking crossouts and shit.
Oh, that'd be fucking hilarious, man.
Right.
But keep a hold of that. That's one of a kind.
Sorry, there's some white out on there. Never mind that.
Yeah, right. So what do you say your biggest show or venue you ever either performed or have GRE do, or just the biggest one that you can think of?
I'd say there's two. I mean, definitely the Roxy in Denver, I've done quite a few times, and that's an awesome venue. Scum really has it hooked up there, and the fan base out there is awesome. So the Roxy, definitely. And then Club Red in Arizona, which I did. I have to give a shout-out to Sharpie with Clickbang Entertainment in Arizona. He brought us out to do a show. It was a Haystack show.
Nice.
In Tempe, Arizona, and yeah, that venue is off the hook. I believe that's where they have Tech come out to and perform. So it's a really nice venue out there. It's huge stage, nice sound. So I would say those are probably the two nicest venues that I've been to. And from my understanding, Jub Jubs is supposed to be really nice, and we're in the big room.
Oh, nice. Venue. Yeah, Jub Jubs is off the hook. All right, we done a couple shows there, and it's a blast.
I have never been to Reno.
Well, last time we did a show there, they didn't have the big room open yet. We were in the small room, and they screwed up a little bit. They told all the artists free drinks,
right,
like the whole night. After like the fourth performer in, they cut it back. They're like, "Oh shit, what are we doing?"
Fuck no. Oh,
like half the room's just wasted already by the fourth performer, and they're like, they're losing hell of money at the bar.
Wow.
That was great.
I have done the Knitting Factory in Hollywood, but I did the small room there. I mean, it's still a dope venue, but I think that the small room only holds like 100 people. So that was cool to perform at the Knitting Factory in Hollywood. But yeah, I would say the Roxy and Club Red were probably two of the nicest venues that I've performed in.
Oh, yeah, dude. Do we got any upcoming other projects we're looking forward to hearing you guys come out with, or any possible surprise co-stars for one of your songs that you might want to throw out there? Fishing around for a little news.
We got some things in the works for sure. Like I talked about before, we got, let's see, for the rest of this year, We're dropping a digital single. It's actually Sly's Wicked He's dropping a digital single featuring me and Cryptic Wisdom. So that's one of the big things that we have dropping. Probably in December, we're going to drop that single. And that's going to be on Sly's Wicked album dropping in March. So we're going to drop the single in December, kind of give people a taste of what that album's going to be like. And then the full album's going to drop in March. We did a song a while ago. I want to say it was like maybe 8 years ago or something like that. We did a song with Sly Boogie on it. You know who Sly Boogie is?
Rings a bell. I'm sorry, I'm not...
From SoCal. He was pretty big in the early, mid-2000s. He's from like San Bernardino area. He's from SoCal and stuff. He was on the radio, had a big song, California. So he was he had a good little buzz back in the day. He did a lot of stuff with some stuff with like Dog Pound. I think he did some tracks with Crooked Eye and stuff like that. But anyways, he had blessed us with a really dope verse back in the day. And so I had an idea to kind of do a remix to that song. It's we're actually working on that right now. It's really dope. So that's going to probably drop before the end of the year. That's a single, but that will also be on the remixes album that drops. And that's going to drop January 1st of 2016. So really, for the rest of this year, it's just two singles we got and then that remix album. But we have a whole host of stuff ready to drop next year. So pretty much the newest records that have come out that everyone should check for, there's my record Mad Scientist that just came out, and then we have one of our newer artists on the label, Big Legion, out of Corona, California. He dropped his album about 3 weeks before mine, and so that's his debut album on GRE. And he's got a lot of different artists on there. Like, he's got GRE artists, of course, but he's got some artists out of Australia and some different cats from like all over. He's got production by a few different cats as well. It's really, really solid album. So if everyone is looking for some new music, Big Legion, Crown Town Villain is the name of that, and then mine called Mad Scientist. So those are the two newest ones that are out.
And where can everybody find all this music at?
Well, you can go to our website where you can find everything, which is grimrealityentertainment.net or .com. But aside from that, any digital or online retailer, so iTunes, Amazon, Google, all that stuff. Some of the albums are even available, like if you go to Best Buy or Barnes and Noble, some of the bigger sites, there are links there to actually buy some of the music through there. But definitely all your normal outlets, we're on CD Baby. So yeah, pretty much anywhere online that you can buy music, you're gonna find our stuff there.
All right, man. Well, we'll go ahead and wrap this interview up. Thanks for your time, man. Greatly appreciate it.
Yeah.
Look forward to seeing you next week, but it's going to be a rocking show.
Right. Can't wait.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I definitely want to give a shout out to Drunk Funk, to all of Sacramento, all my people up there, of course, Gabe and Trim, Rihanna, of course, and definitely looking forward to rocking in Reno with y'all and Shannon. We're going to have a real good time.
Oh, yeah, most definitely, man. Well, thank you for your time, and you have a wonderful night, sir.
Absolutely, brother. Take it easy.
You too, man.
All right.
Bye-bye.